You know what time it is. There's a new category on Twitch, and we are part of it. Oh, yes, we're in. Audio compressor. I think we're working. Okay, let's switch up to the screen here. We'll just can that, let people wait to join in. So, team, we're continuing off from where we were, as usual. That's probably what the streams are going to be for the next couple of months, by the way, is building this project, a full-stack machine learning project end-to-end. So now, let's get the Twitters up. Twitter.com. I need my Twitch URL. twitch.tv/MrDBurke. Let's see if me. As you probably tell, I have a blocked nose, but that is okay. We're still going to party on. You know what I do? Whenever I get the slightest little bit of sickness, I wake up in the morning and I write down on my to-do list for the day is, let's just put it here. Get better. And you know what's funny? It seems to work. I just write down get better, and then by the end of the day, I tick it off and it feels like I've gotten better. And of course, is there a medical reason for this? But the placebo effect works wonders. Let's put it down on Twitter. I'm going live on Twitch. Making my recently deployed Streamlit food image collection app better. Actually, let's go squashing the bugs. My recently deployed Streamlit food image collection app, plus making it prettier. Come and watch me figure things out. Come watch me figure things out and say hi. There we go. Let's get a little wave. And then boom. Going live on Twitch. See, look at this. It's danger of social media. That image is doing things in my primal brain. Let's go to GitHub. Get off Twitter and get onto GitHub. That's what we have to do. Okay, here we go. Practical deep learning. Yum, yum, yum. Glasses, high quality neural networks for computer vision. All right, so here we are at Nutrify. Just so that, actually, that's what we have to do today. Let's write that down. We have to make a test branch, because right now I realize that all the development that I do is on the production app. So we're learning full stack development right here. So this is where we're going. We're going to build a data flywheel, but for now, where we're going. Let's write that. Where we're going. And then right now, building an application to collect data. Okay. And over the next couple of days as well, I'm going to make the GitHub readme a lot better, and then just put a lot of stuff here that you can collect. I've also got a playlist starting to run on my archive YouTube channel. So if you want to watch the streams, like literally unedited, just verbatim, they'll be there eventually as well. So now let's check out where we were. We'll open up VS Code. Siobhan's has been so helpful to also add. Here we go. Thank you, Siobhan. I understand that we want simplicity, but it's also a good idea. So this is what we're going to be doing, actually. We're working. We need to make a test. Streamlit app, GitHub. Make a testing branch to work on instead of working on the production app. Because if I go to even the test app right now, it's going to upload things to our Google storage bucket. So the workflow we have right now is we have an app that allows us to take a photo of food, upload that image to Google Storage, and then stores the metadata about that food in there. Let's get it running, shall we? Nutrify. We got utils and requirements. LS. Streamlit run food image. So this is our app. Oh, this is a little bit different to what you'll find actually. This is running live. So this app URL may be different if you're watching this in the future. Hasmanator says, hi Daniel Burke, I finished your TensorFlow course. It was really good and I enjoyed it. I'm going to take the TensorFlow certificate exam tomorrow. Do you have any advice before taking it? I would go to here, learntensorflow.io, and then preparing for the TensorFlow developer exam. I would read through this and follow all the steps in here. Those are my best advice. Learntensorflow.io, and then this little section here. Preparing for the TensorFlow Developer Certification Exam. So right now, if we upload an image from this app, it goes to the production Google Storage bucket. So let's open that. Console, Google Cloud, and then we want Sheets. We need to make test versions of these. Food vision. So I'm going to make another storage bucket right now. Look at this. We got stuff being uploaded here. Wonderful. So we've got these are images that are being collected right now, but we need to add some quality of life things to the app. Let's put in here projects. Create a project in progress, all things to do with the app that are currently in progress, currently need doing. Add a column to do. In progress. Shabam, what's happening, my friend? Good morning for you. It is good afternoon from me. It's a little bit of a sun shower today. So let's put this over there, put that over there. Issues. We're not uploading anything. Okay. Fix error when not. I like this. You can just put hashtag 2 and it will bring up the GitHub issues thing here. So we need to fix that. Bug. Make it so there's a success message when uploading an image. To do make testing branch. Trying to set up locally. Fix dependencies. Okay, let's work through. We need this one. One of this one needs to be first. This is probably what we're gonna do this stream. Let's move that to in progress. Success message. Okay, one new. Get out of that. What is this? Okay, this is really cool. Hey, Javant, what's going on? Oh, Shabam, great to hear. It is... Samanth, no, this is not... This is probably not for a future course. This is for an actual app that I want to build. Like a full-stack machine learning app. You can see all the code. This is all open source, so You can see it here. It is 3 p.m. where I am right now. Okay, let's go here. Issues. Okay, so we want to... Let's get out of that. Projects. How to make a new Git branch. Or actually, let's upload what we've got so far. I want to... We can delete this. Country, and now we're going to upload label, country, email. I wanna make okay, and now let's go Google Images for banana. We'll just upload these. Because now we've got... a way to fill it out. Look at that. Now, can I put... some text there? See, we get an error. A Hair's too long, you reckon? Yeah, you're right. Okay, we need to fix this as well. Sarav, what's going on, my friend? Pseudomags, hello, hello. Okay. This is what we're going to fix today. So if the submit button is clicked, it's going to... Okay, I got an idea. We'll put some logic in here. Boom. Okay. Now we've got some. Shabam, for now I prefer TensorFlow because I know it more, but it really, really depends. They both do basically the same thing, TensorFlow and PyTorch. I haven't built any ML into this app yet, but for the initial models, they'll probably definitely just be TensorFlow transfer learning. Beautiful. I'm going to get rid of warning. Okay, we fixed the what happens. There we go, beautiful. Okay, I think that's a lot better. Now, where the image gets uploaded, is that important? Well, we can use that later on. So now we've got a way, I'm gonna push these changes because that fixes a fair few things. This is fun, closing issues. Siobhan's, hello. I've just added some great changes to the app. You'll be able to see them here. So now if there's no image, you click upload image. You get please upload an image. And I've put in two little forms here, so if I change this to that and that. No, the PR issues are great. I love them. See, we can start to collect like where people are uploading images from. I think that'll be helpful later on. And then email, we can set that later on. So if we put in someone's email, you can just autofill these as well, so that's pretty easy. Clear form. So now let's see if we, and then if I've got two examples here. Now, if you, we have where the image was uploaded from and who by. So that way, later on, if people want to upload images and we want to say thank you, we could use the email there, yada yada. So now let's make a testing branch. Git checkout, I believe, is it? So what we need to do is make a testing version. Need to make a testing version of the app. So git branch test upload. So the changes have been committed, but now I want a test version of the app. Because right now, if I make any changes and upload them, they go straight to the production version of the app. So let's now make a bucket. Good news is that the app is working. We haven't had any major hiccups. Okay, so now we have, all we should have to do now is Now, forgive me if I'm wrong, but I can just make changes on this code and commit it to the test upload branch, and it won't affect code on the other branch. Am I revealing how poor my GitHub skills are, or Git skills are? Utils. So now I'm going to change this. Food vision test upload. Wonderful. And I'm going to create a new Google Sheet as well. I don't think I'll have to change the credentials though. File, make a copy. Test upload. I'm going to delete most of these. Well, I won't delete them just yet, actually. So if I now change this sheet here, sheet ID, what error do we have? TF versus PyTorch. They're basic, truth be told, like I see them as basically the same thing. Like you could argue that TensorFlow is more used in production settings. So if you want to deploy applications to the web or something like that, whereas PyTorch is more research focus. However, the two are closely like bridging the gap between what each offers. If you're quite skilled in TensorFlow, you could probably pick PyTorch up in like a month. And vice versa. So they really offer similar things. Like, I mean, what are they used for? They're used for automatic differentiation, which is basically building neural networks and having all of the linear algebra and calculus and whatnot done behind the scenes so that you can focus on building state-of-the-art neural networks and deploy them in production. So on the mobile side of things, TensorFlow probably wins out, but just in general, they really do quite offer much the same thing. What you should be focused on instead of like TensorFlow versus PyTorch is like just get really good at one. And as I said, if you get really good at one, you can probably go and learn the other one in like a month or so. So, okay, now we've got a testing version of the app. If I change something here, let's go ST. Right, testing version. What happens here? It doesn't change anything on the main branch. Okay, that's good. Now, start ship.rs. Startship.rs. I can't get there. Siobhan says, did I look into PyTorch? Oh, there we go. Here we want. Okay. Starship.rs. You got this, Shabam. All the best, legend. I'll check out that later on. Thank you for that though. Okay, let's have a look at... Ah, I see. So, Siobhan's, this is... Yeah, I'm gonna have to... Thank you, A1. I appreciate it. Yeah, I'm gonna have to... I've made too many changes. So, Siobhan's, what would you suggest... If I wanted to install like Flake 8, yeah, you're right. I should have type checking and all that sort of stuff and make the code look pretty. Cause right now it's just a... Let's see if the test version of it runs anyway. There we go. Look at that. Look at that success message. How beautiful is that? So now if we go to the testing version. Yes, we got pizza here, but we don't have that Wonderful. And then we have test upload. Yes, nice. Siobhan's, thank you very much. I appreciate that. But I will, let's... If I look at this pull request... I think for... Yeah, I do want to make it more robust and more clear. I think what you're doing now is perfect, like testing the app and then just seeing like edge cases where it doesn't work and where it can be improved. Why can't I push? So git push. Set upstream origin. So this should now have our we should now have the branch on here, shouldn't we? We don't want to merge it just yet. You know what would be good? Is... Yeah, see, this is what I need to change. I would like to only merge one file. So these should stay the same. As in, for the testing branch, these should stay the same, but I only want to merge food image collector. Does that make sense? Yeah, test upload. Okay, how to merge only one file in a pull request. I repository this fork from GitHub, few modifications. The request? Advantage is that you can change the pull request by pushing new changes to that branch. Dan, you could load an environmental variable on your PC. E.g. test equals yes. Because, yeah, you're right. It looks like I have to merge. I like that. If OS, Environ, get test. I could probably actually move save to G Sheets into utils. And then just put the credentials at the top. So you're saying if I put, so if we get clear here, export test dev equals true. Does that make sense? And then that just means every time I want to do test development, I can just set the environment variable to test. Yeah, so this is, okay, this is good practice, team. Okay, let's have a look. I like that idea. Python local test environment best practices. Ah, so this is testing in Django. What do you mean bash RC with a MacBook? I like setting the environment variable. Yeah, ZSH terminal. Yeah, Dodsy, ZSHRC. There we go. ZHHRC. Okay. I get you. This is great. So, wait, what's below there? Nothing. So if then what model am I going to use? Just any image classification model. How to set environment variable in probably efficient net. I think that's the model will be quite the same as what you'll find in section 3. No, actually, section 5 of my TensorFlow course. Or 4. Might have to quit. I like this, setting a test environment. So I'm just writing down what we've been doing. How to create Here we go, this is what we want. Oh, Jesus. Surely this is not half. Siobhan's, that's amazing. Do you mind updating your, you could probably update this on your PR. Just put those steps and then I'll get to it right away, because otherwise it's in Twitch chat. And if I miss the Twitch chat, I'm going to lose all that. And yeah. So if you put those steps or update your PR or put those steps just in an issue or something like that, I'll get to them very shortly. Flappe, how are you? So we're trying to set an environment variable so that if it's in testing, what do I got here? I'm excellent, thank you. We're trying to set an environment variable so that every time we're working on Nutrify locally, we're uploading images to a testing. There should be configs as well. This is good. We're learning a whole bunch of stuff. Echo, export, test, Nutrify, mvar. Beautiful. So now we have an test environment. There we go. So then we've got a testing environment here. So now if we okay, Siobhan, we've got a way to test. This is beautiful. So I think I can can the other branch now. I could actually probably just functionize this. Because we don't want to be, see, let's put this, let's just write it out and see what it looks like. Hello, relax man. Do I use GitHub Copilot? No, I don't. Okay, yes, this is what we're after. Something like this. Okay, does this make sense? Let's see what happens when we run our app. Why did that not work? Oh, because I think our Streamlit app is running. I need to refresh where our Streamlit app is running. Okay, there we go. Using test storage bucket. Beautiful. Okay. We've now got a testing storage bucket. Add code to make testing work if Now there should be a way, we should be able to probably do this. So let's go to GitHub and see what changes we can merge. So what did we cover later? direct cherry. How do I do that? I've seen that before. Project, repo. How do I set that in Twitch? I'm still a Twitch newbie. Okay, so we're now going to delete the branch. Okay, we're back to main. All right. Look at us being like pretty software developers. Twitch bot. How to make Twitch bot for exclamation chat. Twitch chat commands, here we go. Twitch bot. Okay, I see. I'm gonna do that later on. But the repo is here. So we now have a way to test. So the production app should still be working. If someone wants to test that, that would be greatly appreciated. Pull request, closed. Okay. To get Flake 8 MyPy working, install pre-commit using pip. Okay, I see. Copy the YAML file on the PR into pre. Let's do this. Added a bunch of formatting code to make things look pretty when they get committed. Do I want to commit this to the repo? Thank you, Siobhan's. Hey, Sally, thank you for subscribing. Do I want to commit this YAML pre-commit config to the GitHub repo? And now... Hey, there we go. We're making some pretty code here. What else should we work on now? Malicious content? Requirements.txt has all the libraries, not those specific to Nutrify. Okay. Let's have a look at requirements.txt. Oh my goodness. I think you're right. So you were saying, how did I start in a fast development? I didn't really, I haven't done much Flask, to be honest. Is this what you use, Siobhan's, the pip file? For requirements.txt? Issues. I thought I created an env here. Yeah, nutrify.env/env. See, I'm not sure Streamlit. We'll have to look at what Streamlit Cloud uses. I'm not sure if it uses pipenv. I'm in my environment here. GitHub. Okay, we can use pip file, but I'm using Conda right now. Yeah, I have pip as well. Pip. It's because I've got Streamlit and Jupyter and all that sort of stuff here. Yeah, I've got the environment with Conda, but I created a requirements.txt file. Pip freeze, here we go. Yeah, see here. The requirements txt will be all the packages installed on Conda. Yeah, if I go Conda list. I've got all of these. I got a little bit of a blocked nose. What's happening here? What's going on here? Fix end of files failed. Okay, there we go. All right, so what do we have to work on now? I think locally wise, it works great. I'm going to put in here what happens to your images. Flappy, yes. This is just a small little app that is the first stage of a larger project. If we see here, this is the overall what we're trying to do. We now have a working prototype for taking a photo of food, uploading it to a storage bucket, and then have metadata about the food images. And we're going to eventually pass these food images to a food vision model. And then we're going to have that food vision model recognize what's in the image. And then whatever that food gets identified as, we're going to later on display the nutrition information and other food information based on what food is identified back to the device. However, what we're building just for now is a way to upload and store images in a storage bucket and collect metadata about those images, because to eventually build this in a full closed loop system, we want it to be able to just have a large database of images. Now, of course, I can scan the internet and get a whole bunch of existing food images, but I'm just building this to sort of get familiar with creating a way that we can create our own database and then upload it from, sorry, update that database from there. So let's figure out what we have to do for a next step, hey? We'll go to projects. What have we done today? We've set up a test environment. Yeah, that would be good. Thank you, Flappy. I appreciate that. We're just going to close some of these. I wonder if I can put ST caption. There we go. This is a local. I wonder if I put. Save to G Sheets. Now, I believe if we go to ST form, what do we reckon? Does that look better? If we just put a little caption under here? Instead of having it... Thank you, Bill DeGray. I appreciate that. You're right. I want to also fix the form. Beautiful. We can do a spinner. Let's go UX. Okay, now we're just doing a little bit of fun things, not really enhancing the logic of the app. We're just making it look cool. And we're putting some info about what actually happens with someone's image right now. Probably what I want to do as well is next, I'm going to look into SQL. Because although Sheets works, we probably want to eventually start moving towards a database, a proper database. Add success message, yes. There's a testing version of the app now too. Okay. Okay, thank you, Siobhans. I really appreciate your help, actually. So let's now make an image of what happens to someone's photo once they upload, because like it's good to know what actually happens where your photo goes. Like if you see, a lot of web apps don't even tell you what happens. I just want to develop this all in open. That'll be fun. I have used streamlit.io before, but I would say I'm probably like a 4 out of 10 with skill of using it. I'm just practicing at the moment. I really like it. So it's really simple to create Python-based web apps. Like, look at that. And this is hosted for free. Like, you can try this out right now. Like, I definitely, later on, once, like, in a year's time, once I've got this app, like, fully functional and working incredibly well, I definitely want to move towards, like, monetization. So I'm thinking, like for 100 foods, the food vision model could be free. But then if you want to get the big model that works on, say, 10,000 foods, then that would be a paid upgrade, if that makes sense. So let's write down in here. This is what we're, the overall workflow. Right, so if this works for 10,000 foods, I think that's a pretty cool app. I'd pay $5 a month for that. And once we get the flywheel in place as well, then things start to get really fun. Like imagine we have like 1,000 new images get uploaded per day, right? And then the reason why we're getting this database set up really good in the first place is because once the data loop is in progress, like the model code could be automated. So then it would just be like, once the database has another 2,000 images, we would just automatically trigger the training of a new model, have two models running at the same time, like as in one is the production model, one is the shadow model. Only ever change the production model to the shadow model if the shadow model beats the production model on every single parameter. Just like, I basically just want to replicate, I seriously just want to replicate Tesla's data flywheel. Just replicate this entire data engine, but with food images. So image uploaded, uploading workflow. We can delete most of these. Your device. Let's bring this down here. We don't need a model, it doesn't get trained yet. Now this can be, let's make this green. Oh, I think that was a good color actually. Food images get stored. Your device, food images get stored. Now this is Google. Let's get the Google Storage logo without a background. Okay, I want to Google Sheets logo. Is that PNG? This better be PNG. Transparent. If this is not transparent, life is too short. Yo, Rish, what's going on? Bill and Gray, does submission clarify whether to upload an individual food item, or will it be okay with same meals and or rather fruits and vegetables? I haven't decided about that. So you're right. That's going to be something we're going to tackle later on when we start to build the model. I've thought about that a fair bit myself. Like, if you imagine, how do you, like, just think about how many dishes you can create with eggs. Right? So if you have, like, what differentiates, how does someone know, like, the difference between, like, a raw egg in its shell, a raw egg out of its shell, an egg fried, an egg scrambled, an egg sunny side up, an egg flipped, an egg poached. So that's, we've just thought of like 10 different ways, like without really thinking much at all, of how you can make an egg. So that's going to be something we tackle later on, but that's why we're collecting lots of images on food, or like going to be. So yeah, stay tuned. We'll figure that out. Google Sheets logo. Creative Commons. There we go. Thank you, Siobhan's. Once again. This is something, yeah, I haven't thought about, like, of course, we could sit here, like, thinking about, like, how this is going to work from now on, but until, like, we actually start getting into building this stuff. I might delete this and just put that there. Nah, I liked that other. Now let's go here. These are private, but are viewable by I need to update some sort of plugin for Twitch. This should really be a photo of food, shouldn't it? Let's go to Icon Finder. Yeah, Bill, you're totally right. See, that's what we're going to find out later on, that if, like, I've seen those images of, like, yeah, dogs and cats being identified as cheeseburgers and whatever. So what do we want here? We want photo of food. I think I have one for my TensorFlow course. Photo. Food photo. Smartphone photo. Yeah, Bill, if you go to, I've got a couple of courses out actually. Excuse me. Yeah, Siobhan's. That's what we'll be able to, that's sort of why I put in the location, to see where lots of the food images are coming from. I mean, that's, can you imagine in the future, like when we have videos and live streams, where it'll be like, okay, we need 10,000 more foods from this location. Let's source images from that location. That will be fun streams coming up. So let's look into my TensorFlow course images. I think I've got one there. Assets list should be under 3, maybe. I think we'll be able to look at them fast if we look at them as icons. There we go. Food image. Or photo. There we go, team. If in doubt, just put a white square over it. Now we don't want... we don't want a shadow. See, this is what is very important when you're... there we go. What do you reckon? Option one, the apple or the burger? NZ. Beautiful. Is this, do they have an API here, Siobhan's? This is what we'll need. We need an API for this. Wonderful. This is the type of stuff I want to display. Actually, I like the one with more color. Let's leave this here though. These are private, but are viewable. Okay, your device, take photo of food. Yes, let's download this. Downloads. Image. Uploading. I wanna make it. Images. I wanna make it. Thank you for sharing that, by the way, Siobhan's. Wonderful. Okay. So let's now put this in an expander. I wanna make it. I want a man cave. Okay. I like this. Thank you, Siobhan's. And Bill, yeah, this is going to be probably like a fairly long-standing project. Like, we've only done this part, and even though this part, like, this is not even like we've got a basic prototype essentially for this part. Next is to start building a food vision model, and then eventually we want to collect it all into a feedback loop. So let me explain this just out loud. So the end goal, someone takes a photo of food. There's two paths way. So whatever photo gets taken, we'll be very explicit by that. If you use Nutrify, that's like number one T's and C's. We use the photos you take of food and we store them in Google Cloud because we need more food images of whatever it is to improve the overall user experience of the app. And so that's going to be the database. That's the little part that we've just built. Next, we'll be progressing towards making the database a bit more stable, so SQL or something. And then we'll build a food vision model, so an image classification model to identify what's in different images of food. That food vision model will also be running on another version of the app. So you take a photo, the photo goes into two paths. One, it gets stored online. The other path, it gets passed through a food vision model, which is a neural network. The vision model outputs a prediction, say the food identified is pizza. That then gets matched to another database which has nutrition information on that food. And then the nutrition information about that food gets displayed back on the device. However, because machine learning models are probabilistic, there may be times where someone takes a photo of a cat and it gets identified as fried chicken. So that's where someone can be asked to update the model with the correct information. Say, hey, this is the wrong food identified. You said it was pizza, but it's actually a banana. Who knows what the real example might be? And then that wrong food identified gets put back into the database so that future models get improved. Now, a very simple workflow that we could do as well to verify that images are actually of food is you could run more than one model. So this is just one food vision model. You could run a model that detects whether it's like just a binary model. So it goes, is food or isn't food? So as soon as someone takes a photo, the first model it goes through is food, isn't food? And if it's not food, the model will go, hey, please upload a photo of food. And so the way you do that is you just have like 100,000 images of different kinds of food, and then 50,000 images of things that aren't food, could be anything. and then just say, hey, we think your image is not food. Please upload a image of food, and then insert some workflow around that. But we'll get to that later on. Oh, for sure. That's other contributors. 100%. Yeah, definitely. That's why I'm making it open source. So let me be clear that eventually I'd like to create like a business out of this, like a food education business. However, to begin, it's going to be fully open source. I mean, the code is already on GitHub, like for the basic. For the foreseeable future, it will be stay on GitHub. Like, I'd like to take the OpenPilot method. So if we look at OpenPilot, we're going to build a business like this. Just make all of the code open source. Like, look at this. This is open source self-driving. And they have... Boom. All of their code is open source, but they sell a product here. So, developmental-wise, I'll just open source as much as possible. The data will probably be closed source. But yeah, if someone wants to replicate this, they sure can. I want to see this. Basically, the reason why I'm building this is so I want it to exist. I want to just be able to take a photo of any phone photo on my any food on my phone and then just learn about it. Like, where did that food come from? What's the history of it? What are some recipes with it? How long has it been around? Like, if I take a photo of a cup of coffee, wouldn't you want to learn more about, like, where did coffee come from? Like, how long has it been around? What types of coffee are there? When you drink coffee, what happens? What's in coffee? Caffeine? Yeah, sure, but what else? What are all those other things? Now, you see how that sort of just triggers like a cascade of learning about different things. And I know, of course, I can Google what's in a cup of coffee, but I like the fact that it's interactive. It's a two-way street. It's I take a photo and then it comes back. So I like that interactivity. And then, of course, you could do the same thing for... This is a vision model, right? What if eventually we expand this to text? So you take a photo of an ingredients label, and it tells you whatever's in that ingredients label. Say there's like 20 things on an ingredients label and you only know the first three. What are those other things that have like a name that's like 30 letters long? I don't know what that is. I've done a nutrition degree and I still don't know what half the things are on ingredients labels. So wouldn't it be cool to identify that? You could walk through a supermarket and just go, hey, what's this? Oh, that's like 75 chemicals I don't really want to put in my body. So that's later on. Yeah, that's the whole motto of this is like, I'm learning while building this, and people who want to help and contribute are learning while they help and contribute. So now let's clean up some of this. New line. And can you imagine how cool this would be, Siobhan's and anyone else who's watching, like to say, like to know that this is like community driven? Like, that's what I feel like. If I start putting out YouTube videos and keep streaming this, like eventually the community will be uploading their own photos of food, and eventually it's like community will be writing code to make this better, and it'll just be like this huge project that's just driven by itself. Like Tesla cars, right? Tesla, you buy a Tesla and you drive it and it uploads images to or video of you driving, and the car gets better and you keep driving the car, and then the video goes up and the model gets better and you keep driving the car, and it creates this huge data loop. That would be cool. Okay, now let's put a little spinner in here so that while something is executing, spinner with ST spinner uploading your image sending your image across the internet. So now, maybe if we, try to click upload image, please upload an image. Wonderful, now let's practice this. We want steak. Steak, eggs, greens. Where am I uploading this from? AU. And then upload image. Beautiful. Now we need to do one more thing, which is ST form. They said they're like with context. With ST form. This does have a submit button. Kagos, thank you. See you, Siobhan's. Thank you for joining into the stream and thank you for all your help. There's a submit button here. Yeah, you know what I need to do? Restart the app. There we go, team. We figured that out. There we go. Okay. Let's commit this. Add image upload workflow. Let's just make sure that this works. So we're using the test. Steak, eggs, green, test. Beautiful. Five 39 PM. Wonderful. Oh, we got some pretty looking code. Okay, we got something going on here. Okay. I think it's working, but So what did we just do? Done. Add a bunch of info to the app about what happens. Stuck on a pre-commit file, getting mad when I make tomorrow, we'll probably clean up this Notion. Clean up Notion. Clean up repo. Start looking into using SQL. What's the best way to host a model for using it for Streamlit? Get a Streamlit app working for 10 food images. Find a nutrition API for displaying food info. Make an archive of to-dos. Okay, so thank you all for tuning in. I'm going to go for a walk. It is heading towards sunset now, and I've been sitting down for too long. So I believe the app should be up and running. Let's refresh this. Oh, didn't anything commit? The code is on GitHub anyway. Okay, so I'm not liking what's happening with this pre-commit config YAML. Japani, thank you very much. I appreciate it. We're going to keep building this out. As I said, I don't know, as always, I don't really know how to do everything. Well, I actually don't. I don't know how to do 80% of this, but we're going to work it out as we go. I need to turn off the fact that this is not committing. So 15 to 88. How do you get that line in VS Code that tells you how long your code should be? VS Code get Python limit line. Code preferences, settings, search for Python. Code, preferences, settings, Python. Python formatting. Want to disable all of the checks, actually. Let's go to projects. Fix, what's it called? It's buckling the commits. Turn off pre-commit checks. Update. Oh, why isn't this doing? This is not enabling me to commit anything. Update app. Okay, I need to turn this off. Pip uninstall pre-commit. Update app logic. Wow. I need to turn off pre-commit. Okay, I'll fix this tomorrow. What I'm going to do is do a very hacky way of updating my code. Boom, let's copy this and let's just go to the repo. Watch this. You press full stop. On the web editor. And then we can go to here. We go control command A. Command V. Boom. And then go update app logic / add FAQ. To do, pre-commit is breaking, can't add commits, how to fix. Now, if we go to, there we go. The app is already uploaded and running. So yeah, if you want to go and check out the app, it's there. And if you find any issues, please leave it on the GitHub. You can access it there. View the source code on GitHub. Otherwise, if you just go to my GitHub, it'll be under Nutrify. Nutrify there. So there's all the source code on GitHub. But anyway, thank you so much for joining into the stream. I will see you tomorrow. As always, keep learning, keep machine learning, keep moving, keep dancing, keep creating. Peace. How do we turn this off?